Welcome to the C++ User Group. I will talk today about cross-compiling with CMake. First, a disclaimer. I'm not an expert. Everything I present to you, I've learned in the last few weeks. And it's not an easy trade. Cross-compiling is very hard. So I hope I teach the right stuff. If you feel that I'm wrong, then feel free to interrupt me and correct me so we don't distribute wrong information here. Okay, so with this disclaimer out of the way, let's start with the topic. I was gifted a Raspberry Pi from someone who used it, but who had no use of it anymore. It's a very good example for today, so we will use that. So what is a Raspberry Pi? It is basically an image of the board. It's powered via the USB on the top. Then there's an SD card you see beneath it. And it has built-in HDMI, Ethernet, and USB. Also GPIOs on the bottom right, and also like an audio jack and a video you see in the yellow there. And there are also some razors for connecting other stuff to it. So this is a very tiny but very capable computer. Basically, all the I/O is there, so you can connect your mouse and keyboard to the USB, connect the HDMI to a monitor, and then you have a computer. It's not a fast computer, but it's a full computer. So you run Linux on it. Okay, so this is the Raspberry Pi 1B, so the first iteration of the Raspberry Pi. Basically, a full computer with an ARM processor. So it's a different kind than on your normal PC. And it runs a Debian derivative, Raspbian. There are also other derivatives of Linux, but it's always like a Linux system. You can run it as a native system, but you will have a hard time because of all the I/O, and you have to provide drivers for all of them. And with this being a full computer, you can also compile your programs on the Raspberry Pi. But as it's a not very capable computer, it's kind of slow. So it makes sense to compile it on a Linux machine or somewhere else and just copy on the binaries. Let's take a look. What is inside of it? So the main chip, the system on the chip, is a BCM2835 from Broadcom. So it's a 32-bit ARM processor. It's ARM V6, and it has a hardware floating point unit. Runs on 700 megahertz, but it's only a single core. It has 256 megabytes of RAM. And that's basically it. The SD card, you get as much as you have. But the SD card also is not the very fastest storage. So now we know what the hardware is. So what would we need to do to compile a program for a Raspberry Pi? So first thing, we need a compiler. So what comes to mind is there has to be a compiler somewhere. And there's a package that sounds promising. It's called G++ ARM Linux GNU whatever. And there's also something the Clang compiler can also compile for Raspberry Pi. So Clang compilers don't use different packages. You have only one Clang compiler, and you give it an argument, a target, and here the same weird combination of letters is applied. So first question comes to mind, what is this ARM, Linux, GNU, whatever? So let's get this out of the way. So the first thing, ARM, is basically the architecture. So we have an ARM CPU, so it makes sense to have an ARM in the beginning. Second part is Linux. So we have a system that is Linux. And then what's the rest of it? So it's called the ABI, and this is GNU ABI AHF. And yeah, let's take a look at that. This is basically a combination of multiple things. So first thing, it's GNU, that's the variant of ABI. So there's EABI is called from ARM itself, and it's basically names embedded ARM binary. We have a hardware floating point unit. And with that, I hope I have explained the string. So we have now the compiler parts sorted. So we have a GCC, and we also have a Clang. And we also explained the target triple. And now we have the library side for that. On our Raspberry Pi computer, we have to have some Linux drivers going on. So we have to have a C++ library somewhere. And there's a package that sounds very promising, like the G++ multi-library ARM Linux EABI HF. And there's a second option. We could go to the system, to Raspberry Pi, and copy over everything. And this is called a sysroot. But package sounds more promising, so let's try to use that. So we take our GCC for the first try for a Raspberry Pi project. So we start with a Ubuntu Focal, install our packages, like the G++ package I explained before, install CMake, write a toolchain, compile our Hello World, and then we go home and be successful. Okay, so starting with the Linux is easy. Done. Installing packages is also easy. Installing CMake is up to you. And then writing a toolchain. This is new. This is special for writing cross-compiling. So let's do that. So what is a CMake toolchain? Cross-compiling usually means we have to have a lot of settings to get tuned and get right. Like we have this target triple and so on. So that's where toolchain files come from. It's basically a file you specify to CMake. This is CMake toolchain file. And can be anywhere on your disk, but has to be set before we initiate the initial project. Because once project is passed, CMake will identify the compilers, and then compilers are fixed. And once you have created them, there's no way to change compilers. So you have to remove all the CMake build files and start over if you want to change. And it should only contain the stuff necessary to get the toolchain working. Everything custom should be go to the CMake preset. And it's also the place where you can define which toolchain you want to use for your project. And so the CMake toolchain is basically a CMake file that runs before anything else in your project and is there to help you set up and check the compilers. So let's write a toolchain file. So as we saw on the previous slide, we have a toolchain folder where we put all our toolchains, and we create one for the GCC ARM Raspbian. So the first thing is we should set our system processor to ARM. Sounds logical, and also provide a system name. This is Linux. This is not actually used by CMake itself to generate anything useful out of it. But if you use third-party libraries, they will try to switch settings depending on your system processor and your target name. So it's recommended to provide these two settings. Then we have our target triple. So we should save that to a variable. And we also have more specific CPU flags. So for our Raspberry Pi, it's ARM v6, as I said before, but as a Z variant of that. And also the specific Broadcom chip uses this ARM 1176 and so on details. So you will find that on if you look deep enough. And these are our specific CPU settings for the Raspberry Pi. With that, we can now set our compilers. And we use the target triple and place it before the G++10. So I installed G++10, since I omitted so far, but And we also append the CPU flags directly to the compiler. You don't want to use the CMix C flags or CXX flags for flags that are actually necessary to compile it, because the user might want to change them. And if they change the compiler flags, then he wouldn't be in trouble, or he would be in trouble if he can remove our architecture and CPU flags. And we do the same for the C compiler and also the assembly compiler. Assembly is just the GCC compiler, and CMake will make sure that the proper flags are used to compile assembly files with GCC. So that's all we need as a toolchain file. It's not too complicated, and all sounds reasonable. Any questions for that? Okay, this is the first part. What is the main difference between toolchain file and settings, environment variables, CC and CXX? That if you set only the environment variables, you can only change the compiler settings we have on the bottom, but you wouldn't be able to set the system processor and system name. And usually these toolchain files are much more complex. This is just for getting started here, to keep it simple. So there's nothing special about the toolchain file, except that it runs and it evaluates before your project. So you can set all the variables from the outside. You can give CMake command line arguments with all the compilers and system processor and so on. So there's nothing special except that you set it with a CMake toolchain file. It's executed before your CMake files, and all the variables are global. So you can also use the global file for that. With this, we have a good start, and then we compile everything and we get an error. And CMake is telling us that it tried our compilers, but our CPU is actually not supported with this package. So even though the triple from GCC was the right one, GCC is not capable of compiling for a specific CPU on the Raspberry Pi. And the problem seems that the hardware floating point unit uses a thump variant to encode these instructions, and this somehow is not available on the GCC. What this tells us that we need a different compiler. And when we started, we said we have GCC, and also we have Clang. So let's try Trang Take 2. So this time, using Clang, we already know that our triple is not the right one. So we can also not use the multi-lib library package. So we also have to try the sysroot way of doing it. Okay, so then what is to do now? So we start with Ubuntu again, install Clang, install CMake, copy a sysroot, write a toolchain, compile our hello world, and then we are done. Okay, so again, the interesting part is now generating the sysroot. Compiling, installing Clang or CMake should be easy enough. And so what's a sysroot then again? So what we have is multiple options here. So we can copy from the actual system. So we go to the Raspberry Pi and copy all the libraries that are on the Raspberry Pi to our compiling machine. And then we point our compiler to this directory where everything is copied and say, this is the sysroot for our compiler target. But the difficulty is that we have to have all the development packages. So everything, so we need not just the runtimes, we also need the headers and the libraries to link against them. And usually those are not installed on your target. For the Raspberry Pi, we can do that because we can compile code on the Raspberry Pi. But most targets don't have enough RAM to do that. So second option is to use just the packages. So we have a Raspbian, a Debian variant. So there are Debian packages for this platform. And the trick is now we simply use all the packages for the Raspberry Pi, extract the libraries and the headers, and then copy this to a folder. And then we have sysroot that actually works. It sounds a bit complicated and probably is, but I found a script to do that, so it was very easy for me. And I also recommend to use Docker or something for that, so you can change up your sources files and download packages are not actually meant for your system. And then in the end, we only use the sysroot files that we extracted, so we don't pollute our actual systems with something we don't want. So these are the packages I used. So we have some GCC base packages. So Raspberry Pi or the Raspbian Buster is the latest variant. Uses GCC 8 to compile everything for the Raspberry Pi. That's why we have GCC 8 base and some basic GCC libraries for that. Then we have the libc, that's the C standard library. There's also some Linux specific libc stuff. And then there's the lib standard C++ 6. And also we use the libc++ just for good measures. So we have an option to use the lib standard C++ or the libc++. What the libgmp one is, I didn't look it up, but I guess might not be necessary. So, and you can also add any packages you want. So if you have a library that is compiled or has a Debian package, you can add this to your sysroot very easily. Just add the package and then the script will download the package, extract the necessary files like the header, the libraries and the binaries, and then copy everything into a Docker file. And with that, we can now just create our toolchain file. So, toolchain file is now Clang ARM Raspbian instead of GCC ARM Raspbian. System and processor are still the same, just a different compiler. And we have the same target triple, the same CPU flex. And this time we do not use them separately, so we compile like target flex. So we set a target argument and also the CPU flex to give it to Clang. So we do that. I use Clang 12, the latest version. Just add the target with the target triple and the CPU flex. It should work. And the same for assembly and the C compiler. And then we have the sysroot. So we also have a variable in CMake for that. We just set CMake sysroot. So it's already a tiny bit more complex, but not very much. Let's use our toolchain to compile a basic Hello World C++ program, just the main with cout Hello World, and it succeeds. So now we have compiled our program successfully on our Docker image. Now we have to take our binary, copy it to actual Raspberry Pi and run it. As Raspberry Pi is a standard Linux machine, we can SSH into it and just call our Hello World program. And as you see, it works. So Hello World is printed with printf and Hello C++ is printed with standard cout. So both our C library and also our C++ library seems to work very well. Okay, now you know cross-compiling. Now we have seen an example. Let's actually answer what is cross-compiling. So we want to get a bit into the theory of that. As we have now a success, then it might be worth to know a bit more about it. So what is cross-compiling? Basically, you always cross-compile if you're compiling for a different system. So the compiling host machine is different than the target system. So why you want to do that? Multiple reasons. For example, Raspberry Pi, it's too slow. But there might be different reasons. So for example, you have a different processor architecture. We have x86, we have ARM, we have PowerPC, we have RISC-V. And You might even combine different architectures on one project. So you wouldn't want to compile everything on different machine because you want to compile on one project. Oh. One Git repository, basically. It's should still use different projects, but yeah, it's up to you how you do it. But once you compile for a different processor architecture, then it's cross-compiling. But you don't have to use different processor architecture. You can also cross-compile for different processor modes, like for example, 32 bits or 64 bits, or 16 bits or 8 bit or whatever you come up with, or like AVX 512 or some other hardware feature that is actually not available on your compiling machine because, for example, you are developing the new system. You might also compile for a simulation of a processor that doesn't even exist yet. And yeah, there's also cross-compiling between operating systems. So we have Linux, Windows, macOS. But most popular cross-compiling is for Android. So you won't compile your application on the Android phone. You will cross-compile it for that. For Android, Google gives you a very good tool set, so you don't have to bother with everything, all the details, but it still is cross-compiling. Also, if you compile a firmware, like for any embedded device, like a clock or something, or a copier or scanner or whatever, this is also cross-compiled because you cannot compile on the system. So firmware is basically no operating system. You're just running on the hardware. Every driver is written or provided with your firmware. And then there's also cross-compiling between different standard libraries. So for example, we want to have a new libc or a custom compiled libc. You have to cross-compile for it because your host system won't be able to execute the binaries because the libc is different. And also like different Windows system or app environments, different possibilities. Okay, so now you know what cross-compiling is. I have to tell you the first rule of cross-compiling. Don't do it. Why? Because cross-compiling is a world of pain. You have to copy a lot of files, like for the sysroot example, and your debug cycle is very complicated. So you have to compile it and then copy it to Raspberry Pi. If it does work, then great. Success for you, but if it doesn't work, then what do you do? So debugging cross-compiling is actually hard. Also, like if you cross-compile for Windows on Linux, then you have to have a Windows machine to test it. Otherwise, how do you know it works? So if you can prefer actual hardware where you can actually compile your program, if you cannot do that, try to use virtual machines that emulate the hardware, but still allow you to compile in the virtual machine. You can also use Docker. Docker has a QEMU mode. So even though you're using different CPU, so you can, for example, run Docker with an ARM emulation mode. So your Docker image will run like an ARM CPU, but your host is a x86 or whatever. It's not very fast, but it still might be easier to debug and use than cross-compiling. Okay. We are not here to not do it, so, but please consider different ways to do it than cross-compiling. And if you cannot do without cross-compiling, then do never talk about it. Because as I found out while preparing this presentation, the slides become ugly. And most setups won't fit on the slide. So let's violate that again and continue talking about cross-compiling. This time with a blue pill. So like in a matrix, let's take the blue pill and dive deeper. And nobody is stopping us so far, except for internet connection problems and so on. So what's a blue pill? A blue pill is this board I also showed in the invitation for this talk. And as you can see, we have a lot of I/O. These are the tiny spots on the left and the right side. And we have these four colored cable on the top. These are for programming the blue pill. And also power is provided through this cable. With all the pins, we have a lot of GPIO, so general purpose input-output pins. So you can use them to measure if a switch is closed or not. You can also use them to use analog inputs, and you can also use them to output digital and analog signals. It's not very precise, so you wouldn't be able to use it to output sound, even though it might be possible. It's not the best experience ever. And it has also a USB, a mini USB on the bottom left. And you can also use that to power the board. There's a reset button next to the USB-C, USB, and above these are two jumpers. These can be used to basically switch the boot mode. And we have two built-in LEDs. The red one is for power. So all the time the board has power, this red LED will be on. And also the green one, which is a custom LED you can program. Then there's also the oscillator and the main system on a chip in the middle of it. And the oscillator is the silver part that looks like a long shape. So that's our board. And STM32F1, that's the variation of the system on a chip. So STM is the producer, ST Microsystems. 32 means we have a 32-bit ARM, and F1 is a variant of this chip. So different classes, like F1 or F class is for fast, and there's also L part that is for low power, and different kinds of variants from that. So one basically means it's very basic. We do not have a lot of stuff here. And the higher the number go, the more RAM and I/O and so on you get. But it's also not like a sum game. You lose some features to gain other features. Okay, so let's dive a bit deeper. So the system on the chip is not an F1. It's also an O3XP. And this encodes the variant, so the actual board. No, the actual system on a chip. The board basically doesn't contain anything else, but it's how it's connected. And the CPU on the system on a chip is an ARM. It runs on 72 megahertz, and it's a Cortex M3 variant. So there's ARM specified some ARM variants, and these Cortex M variants are for embedded purposes. And we have 20 kilobytes of RAM, so we won't run Linux on that. And we also have only 128 kilobytes of flash. So that's everything we have, but sounds a bit small, but it's actually a lot for this small device. And to program it, you use some kind of external system. I recommend to use the ST-Link. They are cheap variants. So the blue pill board itself usually costs around like $3. And the programmer also like $3. Today, with a chip shortage, it might be difficult to get one. And you also have the option to run Arduino and platform I/O on it. But we won't use that for that today. We just want to go to the bare metal and use our C and C++ compilers for that. So as an actual goal, we would like to compile a blinking LED. A blinking LED is basically the Hello World program of embedded systems. And we can blink the LED on different systems. So as we have only one LED, it can only blink. It can blink slow or fast, but usually that's not the variation we want. So what do we want to do to get the LED to blink? So we have to initialize the oscillators. So when the CPU starts, it will go to a boot up cycle that basically ensures that the CPU is running stable. And these blue pill boards are very easy on that, so you don't have to do it, but initializing the oscillators will use external oscillators, and these are much more reliable. They run on 8 megahertz, and you divide this clock to get 72 megahertz, so divide by 9, I guess. And then we have everything stable. Next step would be to initialize the I/O on all the embedded boards, usually to save power. Everything is disabled when you start up at boot. And if you don't initialize it, then nothing will work. So we have to initialize the LED and also configure the general purpose input output that we want to output something. And this is that's an LED that we have to. So we also have to configure that some current will flow to make the LED light. Even though the LED is built in, it's still a general purpose I/O port and nothing special about it. And finally, we set up the SysTick. So basically, we have an interrupt that is called on whatever frequency we configure. And with this SysTick interrupt enabled, we then can toggle the LED and be happy. Okay, so now you know a bit about embedded programming for firmwares. So what's our setup? So we need, again, a compiler, some libraries, and then a toolchain. Okay, 3 parts on our to-do list. Let's start with getting a compiler. So to get a compiler for that, there's a website on the arm.com homepage where you can download a GCC variant that is patched to work for these embedded processors. It also is the basic GCC package, has some patches for extras, but it also comes with some nice tools we want to have. So first thing is we have bin utils. These are required to convert our binaries we get out of it. And also we have a debugger. So we can debug ARM CPUs with that. And we have a libc. And this new lib is basically a stripped down version of the lib standard C and lib standard C++. So we get actually the full way to C++, but all the systems that are not available without a Linux system are not present. So using standard file system is not an option. But we get vector and whatever we want. Okay, so we have the compiler now. So let's write a toolchain for the compiler. There are multiple toolchains for here, so let's see how this looks now. So we have the GCC ARM non-AABI. So this triple here means that we have an ARM CPU again, but this time we have no Linux, so it's non, and AABI, again, embedded ABI. So we set the system variables for CMake to ARM and generic. That's how it's done, how everybody does it. And then the triple ARM non-embedded ABI. And this time compiler flags are a bit more interesting because now we don't have to just pass the CPU flags. We will get later to what specific CPU flags we have, But we also have to use the features, data sections, and function sections. These are used for the linker script later to lay out everything, because unlike a binary you run on Windows or Linux, we have to flash the firmware into the flash memory. And for startup, we have to copy the data section to RAM and run our initializers. And to be able to do that, we need data sections and function sections separate. And the next thing is a flag for the linker. That's the WL. And we want to garbage collect the sections. So this runs a garbage collection, no matter what your compiler sections you have, before the final binary is created. And this removes all the data and functions that are actually not used in your program. And the specs, nano specs, means that we are using the new libc and not the standard C library. This will save us some bytes in the end. And the remaining part is the same. So we used to set up our GCC for Raspberry. We do the same here for our Blue Pill. And then there's one more thing we have to do. We provide a CMake size tool. It's strictly speaking not necessary, but it's very useful to know how big your final firmware has become. Because with that, you monitor, does it fit in the flash? Does it, or did it do the right thing? And okay, but that's not too different. It's a bit more compiler flex than before, but yeah, doable. And there are some more flex we have to add here. Basically, as we are adding a compiler for firmware that the CMake system doesn't know, we have to also provide what executables we are generating. And the common thing is to suffix them all with .elf. That's the format they're encoded in. This elf format is used for GDB and also QEMU and so on. But most tools or some tools like flashing it on the system won't work with that. But that's the main thing that is generated, contains all the debug information and everything. And then we have one more option to set, because CMake, when it sees our new compiler, will test the compiler features. So it will take a look what versions of C flags and so on are supported, because it doesn't know our GCC. And usually it compiles executables for that, but as we are cross-compiling for firmware especially, there's no way of executing them. For Raspbian, there might be a way to compile them with or run them with QEMU, but for firmware, it makes no sense. It doesn't even link the binary because yeah, the linker file is not there. So we have to use static libraries for that. For our Blue Pill board here, these are not all the settings you need. These are all the necessary settings to get a working firmware, but I would always use more flags for that. And all the custom settings in CMake should go to a CMake preset file. And I will show you the configure preset part of it. So for our GCC Blue Pill, we set all the recommended flags here and not in the toolchain file. Why? Because these preset files you can override with the CMake user presets to experiment with your local settings. So if you think, ah, these settings are not the best for you, then they're easy to change. The toolchain file usually is used by multiple projects, so multiple different firmwares, you wouldn't want to change them, or someone else will complain because something changed. Okay, so. There is a section called cache variables where we can set CMake variables for our configure step. So first thing is we actually point to our toolchain file GCC Blue Pill is not so far a toolchain file I've shown you, but this is the final toolchain we will use. Then we want to export our compile commands. So we actually can see which flags are used by the compiler for each and every CPP file and object file linking and so on. So that's very useful to debug if you have done something wrong or something didn't pick up. I would recommend to always use that. Then there's the some flags. So for C++, we wouldn't want to use runtime type information. We wouldn't want to use exceptions. And we also don't want to warn on volatile usage. Because we are an embedded system, we have to compile all the drivers, and those use volatile storage for the I/O a lot. So, and once, usually this is hidden behind the C wall, so C++ compiler wouldn't complain, but it occurs that we are peeking through this and making use of volatile variables in the C++ compiler. So let's not warn on that. And we also want to use some different debug options. These are basically ensuring we are using the latest debug version that might not be compatible with older GDB libraries or whatever, but these are much smaller. And size and firmware is everything. Being able to run a debug version of your firmware on the system is basically essential to get to know what is actually happening, because we don't have a display, and how would you know what's going on? And the G3 variant of the debug settings are smaller, so let's use that. And for a release build, we can get a step further and use interprocedural optimizations, so basically LTO, link time optimization. This also shrinks our firmware significantly. And we can also set some flags to inform CMakers that our compilers are actually working. So we'll skip the testing. So it will not try to run the compilers to find out if they actually work. Doesn't save a lot of time, but yeah, depends on your system if you can measure it. Okay, so this is basically everything so far for the compiler side. So as you can see, we have a lot of options. They are split up between the toolchain file and the preset file, depending if they are necessary to compile the firmware or if they are recommended to compile the firmware. Second part was the library. So for our little system, for Blue Pill, we need to have some libraries to talk to the I/O. And STM provides these as useful packages on GitHub page. And for the F1 variant, we have the STM Cube F1 variant. There's a software provided by STM, the STM Cube MX. This is basically a studio to generate C files or C projects. As we want to use C++, it's of no use, but the library part is very useful for us. So we use this, and it contains CMSys. CMSys is basically a core Cortex-M system library. It's specified by ARM, so you can also get it from the ARM webpage if you want, but it's already included here. And then STM also provides some coherent system for the rest. So for hardware access, we have the low-level drivers, and we also have some hardware abstraction layer driver. These are basically headers that are easier to use. Low-level part is just like pointing to a memory address where an I/O pin is listening, and you have to figure everything out yourself. So which flags you have to set in which order to get it run. And the whole abstraction library is a bit more forgiving. You can actually use features and say, okay, I have this GPIO pin, I want to toggle it and use it, instead of writing to random memory addresses somewhere special. Not all features on the hardware have hardware abstraction layer, so some features are only in the low level accessible. And then there are also some more parts like the board support package. These are special drivers that are only available on certain boards. So usually if you have an actual project and you provide your special hardware drivers in these PSP packages. And there's also like middlewares that, for example, for USB, to get USB to work, you have a lot of protocol stuff, and there's some support for that. And there are also some examples how to use all of these things, very helpful, but they're all in C, so there's no C++ part of it. Okay, now that we know our libraries, we can actually write our toolchain for our board. So, as we have seen before, it's in a toolchain folder, GCC, BluePill. So, just using the compiler and the board, because it's easy to remember. And what we do is we set a board variable. I use it internally to switch between different CMake settings to get the linker scripts and so on. These are specific to your project usually, but are also specific to your board. So you have to have some criteria where you can switch on that. Then we have the MCU and the family. I use those variables to actually compile and use the STM32Cube F1 package we have seen before, so the libraries. And now we can actually define the CPU flags. These are quite simple as we have no hardware floating point or anything. It's just a Cortex M3 CPU. And we want to encode the instructions in the thumb mode. So ARM processors have two modes. One is the old ARM mode, that is, each instruction has the same size. And then there's the thumb mode where the size of the instructions vary. So most instructions are still 2 bytes, but you can have instructions up to 4 bytes. That's a bit harder to decode, but as RAM is so scarce, we want to have the last bit of bytes or the least amount of bytes for our code. So we use the thumb mode. And it's, I guess, only mode you can actually provide these BluePill boards. But I have not tried it, so it might be different. And then we just include our other toolchain. So we can actually, since some latest CMake versions use the CMake current list here, which is the toolchain folder, and then include the GCC ARM non-embedded ABI toolchain from that. Okay, so now I've talked for almost an hour, and let's see for the first time some C++ code. So how does main file for our BluePill board look like? Actually, it's quite similar to a usual C++ application. You have just the main. Usually, your arguments are actually not provided, so there will be never any arguments given to your main. But you can compile it for emulation purposes, where you give your main arguments or pass arguments to your main program. For example, if you want to run unit tests, you actually don't want to run them on the BluePill. You will run them in emulation modus. And your emulator is usually a QEMU with a lot of RAM, so there's no issue in passing arguments or printing out colorful error messages and so on. So what goes inside the main? So we call hall init. That's provided by the hall library itself. And we don't have to write any code for that. Then we have our 2 steps, init clock, so where we initialize our oscillators and enable systick. And then we have init LED, where we initialize our LED. And once these succeed, we go into a while true loop. That runs forever, where we toggle our pin and GPIO-C, and pin 13 is our green LED on the BluePill board. So basically, you have to know a lot of details about the board to write actual code for it. And then the hall delay waits for 500 milliseconds. It's also an instruction provided by the library. So what is now missing is the init clock and the init LED pin. Those are very specific for embedded software, so I won't show them, basically C code. But you see that the main program is actually not very scary. Like it is like normal C++ code. Okay, so I want to show you one thing more before we close, and that's the main the CMake file that is used to build our blinking LED program. So it's obviously something special here, otherwise I wouldn't tell you, but the executable itself looks like a normal CMake executable. So we compile the main CPP to an executable blink. We also set our target features, for example, C++ 17. It's readily supported, so we have GCC 10, quite the latest. So today the latest is GCC 11, but yeah, it's very close. So we have a lot of features also like from C++ 20 we can use. And then we link our whole library. So this one is special and we have to somehow provide it. That's a bit more complicated. I won't show that. And then the fun begins. So we also have to set our some system or linker options. The first option here is that we want to generate a map file. These map files, they will tell us what part of the program did actually compose the final firmware, where it was placed in the RAM or the flash memory, and also which parts of the program were discarded. So it's very useful if you want to debug the garbage collection part and so on, and actually inspect what is going on. What did the compiler actually do with all the stuff we provided them? And the second part is the specs gnosis spec. This is basically a replacement for the operating system parts. So in C++, we have some instructions like standard exit and so on. And these functions won't link if you provide no Linux system or no standard library, basically. So we also provide this spec. Why do you provide the spec here and not in the toolchain file? Because actually it's optional. So for the blinking LED example, you can get the firmware to run without this spec file because we are not using any exit functions or anything. So we are going to infinite loop and this always works. And the second thing is you can use a different standard library that depends on a debugger being present, but it's for another day. And there's some more fun to it. So we provided a CMake size tool, and this tool is executed post-build of our Blink firmware. It uses a terminal, and this tool will basically print out the sizes of our firmware. And there's one more step I want to show you. And as I told you, the ELF format is not the final format. A very good format is the IHEX format, because it still contains where on the flash the parts of the different parts of the programs have to be placed, but it doesn't contain any debug information and so on. And these hex files are used, for example, by the ST-Link flash utility. So you want to generate your hex file right away after each build, so you're ready to flash it to your system. There's also like a binary format that's more simple, but you would then have to provide the starting address where you want to flash your firmware because it's just a binary dump. Okay. With that, we have everything. And the blinking LED, it just blinks. So nothing to show here. Let's summarize again. So we have seen today some cross-compiling. I have shown you in very large detail how CMake toolchains work. So toolchain files are nothing special in the CMake world, just The only thing that is special at normal CMake files, all your variables are local to the directory. So unless you are in the top directory, the variables you set are not visible from the outside of this directory. So in toolchain files, this is different because even though you're in the toolchain folder, these variables are visible everywhere else. And I've also shown you what sysroot is and how to use it. So you either copy it from the target machine or you generate it from packages. And you can also compile your sysroot. So this is also an option, but might take a while to compile all the libraries with your compilers. So usually getting a sysroot somewhere else is recommendable. And we also have seen that Clang works very well for Raspberry Pi. GCC did not so well. And also Clang as a project can compile for almost any hardware we can imagine. And GCC and Clang have different approaches. So for GCC, you have different executables depending on what hardware you are targeting. And Clang is always using the same tool. And we've also seen how to use the ARM-provided GCC for the blue pill. And there's much more we have not seen today. So what we have not seen is some real-world experience, simply not enough time here to do that. And there's also a Raspbian GCC toolchain I have not shown. There is a community project where modern GCC compilers are used to build it. I wouldn't recommend it because those tool chains get very large. So my Docker image was like 2.6 gigabytes. I would recommend to use Clang. It's much more easy. You can also, and vice versa, use Clang to build for Bluepill. That's a lot harder because there's no ARM provided Clang. So we are missing all the other tools we need. But it's possible. So we have to combine parts from the GCC toolchain and also Clang itself, and then we get it to work. But it involves a lot of tuning on the toolchain files. And there are also like a lot of commercial toolchains for embedded. Unlike on the desktop, where basically everyone is using a free option, the embedded world is still using commercial compilers, because they are tuned to make very small binaries. So usually like 20% smaller than your open source variants. And I also did some experiments with SIG. So SIG is a new language, but the tools for SIG also provide backward tools to compile C and C++ code. And with this, it's very easy to compile a hello world in just C++ for a Raspberry Pi, for example. It would be easy, but because it's just you download SIG, it's 50 megabytes, and then SIG will compile everything that's necessary to run on a Raspberry Pi. The only problem is that SIG is very zero dot something, so these setups are not actually very sound and fail. So I have to, it was necessary to patch some files for getting it to work. So I cannot recommend it, but it's an option. And then I also didn't show any actual demo here. We can do that afterwards if you want. So with this, I can only encourage you to try more. It's a very challenging thing. So actually cross-compiling is like taking the blue pill and following the rabbit hole. How deep does it go? So if you ever want to use some hardware projects, then try it. Okay, so I didn't introduce me. So I'm Andreas Reischuk. You will find me everywhere on the internet as OpMind. And I'm usually giving C++ courses, also training Qt and clean code and whatever you want. So you can also hire our company, Hickenegg Software. We will help you to build better software. And we are focused on C++, Qt, but do a lot of more work. So we are also .NET and everything else. We are local to Dresden. So speaking of Dresden, you're here on the C++ user group. Please consider giving a talk. We're always looking for speakers. We will video record every talk you give. I will give a city tour if you like once the pandemic is over. And also, I will visit your local user group if you want and give a talk there. So there's also my spare time hobby project, the Rebuild Language Project. If you're interested in building new languages for native compilations, then please contact me. I'm always happy to discuss anything regarding Rebuild Language. And this concludes my talk here. Thank you for your attention. And now I'm open to any discussion you want. Do you have any experience with cross-compiling, any issues? Yeah, good to see that you like it, Philip. Okay, if there's no question, nobody coming up, then I will stop the recording. Seems it's already long enough. And we can talk after that.